بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن خير الكلام كلام الله، وخير الهدى هدى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم تسليما كثيرا، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. أعاذنا الله تعالى جميعا من نار جهنم ومن شدتها. We have suspended our classes for about 2 weeks or something like that due to the fact that we traveled to the blessed land of Mecca and then Medina, walhamdulillah. And the main reason for traveling there was to participate in a Dawra Mukathifa, a very intense seminar that was given by a sheikh that I hadn't heard from prior to me going. And it's none other than a sheikh, Salih ibn Abdullah ibn Hamd al-Usaymi, ra'ahu Allahu ta'ala wa hafidhu Allahu ta'ala, who I can say is an Allama Haqqa, and he is the Musnad of the Bilad of Al-Najd. Tremendous scholar from the scholars of Al-Islam. I don't say he's the most knowledgeable person in the world, because we don't have that type of ghulu in people. Ghulu is a big mushkila during this time. It's always been a mushkila. It's how a shirk has entered upon Bani Adam, that they go overboard. Someone like us, we meet a person of high caliber in knowledge, we meet that individual, we go overboard in him. And Al-Islam doesn't want us to go overboard. We have to stay in the middle concerning all of our affairs. If we were to see a sheikh, and he was the best sheikh that we've ever seen, we have to compare him to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We have to say to ourselves, if this sheikh is like this, then I wonder how the Messenger of Allah was sallallahu alaihi wa ala alihi wasallam. But doing the lives that we live, popular culture, the way we live, how people are into athletes, how people are into entertainers, we go overboard, over what Allah Azza wa Jalla has legislated. And even with the Nabi of Islam, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, we don't go overboard in him. We don't make dua to him. We don't worship him. We don't attribute to him things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has negated, like the fact that he didn't know the ilm al-ghayb, the fact that he was nothing other than a human being of spectacular caliber, but nonetheless a human being. He didn't create himself, and he didn't have the ability, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, to pull to himself benefit or to push off of himself harm. With all of the mu'jizat that Allah Azza wa Jalla gave him, he didn't have the ability to bring to himself benefit, and he didn't have the ability to push away from himself harm. That reality becomes quite apparent and clear to the uqala of this ummah, the hukama. People have intellect and they have wisdom. If he can't bring to himself benefit and push off of himself harm, why in the world would any individual take him as an aliha, someone or something to be worshipped along with Allah, by making istighatha with him and by him, by making dua to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And if he doesn't have that ability, then everyone who is lesser than him, كُلُّ مَنْ دُونُهُ فَمِنْ بَابِ الْأَوْلَى. Everyone lesser than him, if he couldn't do it, then everybody else can do it. Sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. So I'm مُسْتَغْرَبْ مُنْدَهِشْ when I see some people from this ummah, whether they claim to be connected to the sunnah or not. All we hear and all we see coming out of their mouths is the sheikh said, the sheikh this and the sheikh that. And all they give is the sheikh, the sheikh, the sheikh. May Allah Azza wa Jalla bless, protect, and give his mercy, maghfirah, his rahmah to the shuyukh of al-Islam. But may he protect us from worshiping the shuyukh and making our religion the religion of the sheikh said, the sheikh said. For verily, that is what the Yahud and the Nasara were upon. And as the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لَتَتَّبِعُنَّ السُّنَنَ مَنْ كَانَ قَبْلَكُمْ شِبْرًا بِشِبْرًا وَذَرَاعٍ بِذَرَاعٍ. You people are going to follow the ways of the people who came before you. You're going to follow them a hand span by hand span and an arm span by arm span. The companions, they say, Ya Rasulullah, are you referring to the Jews and the Christians? He said, well, men and nas, who else am I talking about? So everything that the Jews and the Christians did, we're going to do. And what they did was, they took, as Allah said, وَاتَّخَذُوا أَحْبَارَهُمْ رُحْبَانَهُم أَرْبَابًا مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ. They took their monks and their priests as lords along with Allah. Before I share with you, brothers, what I wanted to tell you about the many things of the benefit, the fawaid, and the ibar of the trip that we took, something I have to bring to your attention, and that is, on my Facebook, the administrator of my Facebook, he put on that Facebook an incident that happened when I was over there. I performed Hajj this previous year, walillah alhamd. And from the fadl of Allah upon me, as I've been to the blessed land of Mecca and Medina many times since I became a Muslim in 1986. If I said 50 times, I wouldn't be exaggerating. I didn't count it, but I went through about 5 or 6 passports already. I've been there at least 50 times. Not a single one of those times that I pay £1, $1 in order to go. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he invited me there and he made it easy and made it free of charge. I don't say that to brag. I just say that in order to say, ذَلِكَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ يُؤْتِهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. I'm not some special abd from the ibad of Allah, but the Kaaba is like that, and the Prophet's masjid, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is like that. If Allah wants you to go there, you're going to go there, and no one can stop you. And if he doesn't want you to go there, you're never going to go there. Ad-Dajjal, la'natullahi alayhi, you'll never be able to go to Mecca and Medina, because Allah Azza wa Jalla has put a permanent barrier up that he won't be able to go. So there are those people who go and they arrive in Medina, they never make it to Mecca. There are people who go, they arrive in Mecca, walhamdulillah, and they never make it to Medina. And then there are those people who never arrive to Mecca or Medina. So you guys have to, inshallah, azza wa jalla, take the fact that Allah Ta'ala has chosen me, a miskeen abd, from the projects in New Jersey. I don't know if you guys know what the projects is, but the point is, I'm from the projects of New Jersey. And Allah Azza wa Jalla has brought me over there multiple times. Make dua to Allah Azza wa Jalla and do what you have to do. Make efforts in order to go, and from those efforts is to make dua. Ala kullin, this previous Hajj, I performed the Hajj that we hope and we ask Allah Ta'ala in yataqabbalaha minna. And at that Hajj, we met a brother from Manchester and that area. We met a brother from that area. Originally, he was born and raised in London. His father went to al-Hajj, or went to Umrah, a few weeks ago, along with his mother, his younger brother, and his younger sister. And his father became ill after performing the Umrah. And he became deathly ill, not just ill, but deathly ill, where he went into the hospital in a comatose state in Mecca. And then they transferred him over to Al-Medina. When I arrived there, that was the situation. So the brother came over there and we met up with the brother and we went to the hospital and we took a video of the brother and we asked the people from our community to make dua for him. And I saw the response of the people on the Facebook, social media. It was an overwhelming support. A lot of dua for the man, mashallah. Well, I'm here to say that that man, a Sheikh Abdul Khaliq, he died. He died a few days ago. After being in a coma all of those days and being in a critical situation, he was trying to come out of that coma, but Allah Ta'ala didn't decree that. He didn't decree that. Death came to him and he died. So the first thing I want to mention is that first, on behalf of that family, want to thank all of those people from our community, from this ummah, brothers, sisters who we know, we don't know, who responded with a lot of support, a lot of dua. Want to thank them for their concern and for their dua. That's the nature of Bani Adam. All of that outpouring of support and dua, all of that, but it wasn't enough to change the qadr of Allah. And that's because Allah, Azza wa Jalla, what He decrees, that's what's going to happen. In the hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhu, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told Abdullah ibn Abbas, if all of the jinn and all of mankind were to come together to help you, make dua for you, to assist you, they can't help you with anything other than what Allah has decreed for you. And also, if they came together to harm you, they can't harm you with anything other than what Allah has decreed for you. So if Allah decreed it, it's going to happen. And if Allah didn't decree it, it's not going to happen. And that's our job and our responsibility as the sons and daughters of Allah, of the Prophet, of the Prophet Adam, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. As the sons of Adam, all we can do is make dua and make effort. But the final, ultimate outcome is left to Allah Azza wa Jalla. I mentioned that, although all of us know that, as a dhikr to people who forget that, when they find themselves in tough circumstances, whatever situation we find ourselves in, you want to get married, you want to save your marriage, there's some medical issues going on, you have some issues with immigrations, your case is only going to be rectified if Allah Azza wa Jalla wants it to be rectified. All we can do is Bani Adam, the sons of Adam, the daughters of Adam, is do the things that we've been told to do, like make dua and take the necessary steps and precautions to ensure, inshallah, khair and to prevent evil. So the people made dua, but Allah Azza wa Jalla, He decreed something else. We look at the Quran, in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah just told him, you do, and the rest leave it up to Allah. And that's a consistent story throughout the Quran. All of those prophets and all of those messengers, like Musa touching the Red Sea, Allah said, take your staff and touch the Red Sea. He has to make the movement and touch the Red Sea, and the Red Sea opens by Allah's permission. Not because of the staff of Musa, and not because of Musa. Maryam, when she had the baby, or when Maryam had the baby, Isa ibn Maryam, the angel came to her and said, shake the tree. You shake the tree, and from the tree there's going to fall to you your sustenance from the rotab or from those dates that she was going to eat from. But if she just sat there and just left the tree, there's nothing's going to fall. You have to get up and you have to shake the tree. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, before engaging the kuffar of Quraysh in the battle, Allah told him, throw. Just pick up some sand and just throw it. Then he told the Nabi when he threw that sand, you didn't throw when you threw Muhammad, but Allah was the one who threw. Meaning, when He threw the sand, it went into the eyes of all of those kuffar of Quraysh, although they were a far distance from Him, but you just do what Allah told you to do and leave the rest to Allah and leave the rest on Allah. So that brother, his father, a Sheikh Abdul Khaliq, he checked out while we're in Medina. So we want to first of all thank all of the people who supported him in dua. Secondly, we want to say that the Muslim always has to put his situation into perspective. When we look at the death of that man, we look at his death and we say, based upon the Quran and based upon the authentic sunnah of the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there are a lot of positive points where if an individual, he were to weigh what's going on by the kalam of Allah and the guidance of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he will be mustabshar. He will be an individual who is happy. There are some signs. There are some positive signs. For an example, the fact that the Prophet said in an authentic hadith, sallallahu alaihi wa ala alihi wasallam, man istata'a minkum man yamuta fil madina falyamut, fa inni ati yawm al-qiyamah shafi'an lahu. Any of you Muslims, any of you people who have the ability to die in Medina, then let him die in Medina. For verily I will come yawm al-qiyamah and I will intercede for him on his behalf. So a person who dies in El Medina Nabawiya, that's a good sign. If you die in Mogadishu, if you die in Brooklyn, New York, if you die in Mirpur, if you die anywhere in this earth, in Qahira, Allah's Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will not be an intercessor for you as a result of dying in that place. But if you happen to die in Al-Medina, then Yawm al-Qiyamah, the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he will come Yawm al-Qiyamah and he will be an intercessor. That man, he was driven to his death. From London, he went all the way over there. He was in Mecca, lost consciousness and became sick in Mecca. They changed his position in Mecca and sent him to Al-Medina, and that's where he died. So as a family member, as a person who knows that individual, I'll say instead of going crazy, instead of ripping my clothes off, instead of cursing Allah, instead of abandoning the deen, instead of having weak iman, questioning Allah as his relative, as a Muslim, I'm going to say, hey, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he is a sadiq and mastuq. He is the one who is truthful and he should be believed. So based upon those statements, I'm going to look at that as a positive sign. In addition to that, if a person is born, is dying in Medina, he's going to be prayed over in the Prophet's masjid, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. I encourage all of you brothers to do whatever you can to make your way over to Arabia, to Medina and Mecca, because there are ibadat in that place, worships, ibadat, that can only be done over there. We just pray Salat al-Isha. And the prayer that we made is going to be 27 times more than the one who's praying in his house in Small Heath, in Spark Hill, in Spark Brook. 27 times. Because we prayed in the Jama'at. But when you pray in Mecca, it's going to be 100,000 times that 27. When you pray in Al-Medina, it's going to be 1,000 Salat of Al-Isha times and multiplied by 27. Ibadat that can only be done over there. And that's from, again, ذَلِكَ فَضُلُ اللَّهِ يُؤْتِهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. And we gave that darus about Allah Ta'ala choose what he wants to choose. He legislates what he wants to legislate. He gives virtues to whatever, whomsoever, that he wants to. And that's our religion. مَا كَانَ لَهُمَ الْخِيَرَةُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَىٰ أَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ. The people have nothing to say in these regards. وَرَبُّكَ يَخْلُقُ مَا يَشَاءُ وَيَخْتَارُ. Your Lord creates whatever he wants to create, and he chooses what he wants to choose, and he chose that special place to have all of this reward. عَلَى كُلِّن. The Sheikh Abdul Khaliq, rahimullahu ta'ala, he died in Al-Medina as a result of that. The people of Medina prayed over him in the Prophet's masjid. Was his janazah. And he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if 100 people of a tawheed, one hadith said 40, and another hadith said 100, and both hadith gave the condition that the people are the people of a tawheed, if they pray over that individual, then they will guarantee that he's going to go to Jannah, and they're going to also make intercession on his behalf. So that's what happened to the man, inshallah, over, I mean, how many tens of thousands of people prayed over his janazah? So that's a positive sign for the relative to look at, not to leave his deen, not to ask questions, why did Allah do this, why did Allah do that? Put his situation in perspective. In addition to that, because there are many issues, I'll only mention a few for the sake of the family and for the sake of people who go through these types of issues. Allah Azza wa Jalla mentioned in the Quran, "Asa an takrahu shay'a wa huwa khayrun lakum." It may be that you hate something and it's better for you, and it is good for you. Something may be happening to you and it's better for you. That divorce may be something that is better for you. The fact that you lost that job may be better for you. The fact that you got kicked out of that university, it may be better for you. We don't know. Allah knows and you don't know. Point is, we have to try to find the medium where we're going to exist in a way where we won't be the people who are pessimistic or negative, but we're the people who are looking for these proofs and these adillah that show us, hey, there's light at the end of the tunnel. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam mentioned an authentic hadith showing the virtues and the positive outlook that we should have in this situation that happened, although it is a catastrophe, and we say, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un, is the fact that the Prophet says, Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Innama al-a'malu bil-khawateem. Your deeds, each and every person here, your deeds are going to be determined and judged based upon the last thing that you do. Going to Jannah, going to the hellfire, the last thing that you do, the last thing that you did before you died, it's going to determine where you're going. Are you going to the hellfire, you're going to the Jannah. So if you wind up doing a good deed, and it's from the last things that you put forward, it's an indication and sign, bi-idhnillah, that you're going to go to the Jannah. And if you get caught when you check out and when you die, and the last thing that you did was from ash-shar, the evil, then it's a sign and indication you may wind up in the hellfire. So in this case, the Sheikh went to perform Umrah. Not only to perform Umrah himself, but he brought his wife and he brought his children. So the fact that he died performing Umrah or after Umrah, that's a good sign. We're in the masjid right now. If someone were to die after leaving the masjid, all right, we're going to look at him. We're going to ask, oh, what was the last thing that he was doing when he checked out? We're going to say this is a sign and indication that this individual, inshallah, he had a good khatima. And there are many issues that the Prophet ﷺ told the companions that we should look for in this regard. Now is not the time for that particular darus, but I'm saying this, ikhwani, mainly and basically and primarily for the family. One of the benefits of death, and death is a problem. Death is a problem. So he prohibited us. He said, La yatamannanna ahadukum al-maut li musibatin usiba biha. None of you should ever hope for death because of a catastrophe that hit you. Something that happened to you that was really bad. Never say, oh Allah, caused me to die. Because being on this side of the earth is always better than being on the other side of the earth. Being under that ground, being buried dead, you're done. Unless you have some kind of sadaqah jariyah jumping off in your case, then you're done. Whereas if you're on this side of the earth, you have every opportunity to make tawbah. At-ta'ibu min adh-dhanbi kaman la dhanba lahu. The one who made tawbah from his sin is like the one who doesn't have any sin. If he's dead and he's under that ground, khalas. Stick a fork in him because he's done. Finish. So the Muslim, he doesn't allow himself to check out in the cowardly way by committing suicide. No matter what's going on, no matter what's going on, it's better for you to be on this top of the ground so that you can hope for a better day, hope for a tomorrow. So with that being the case, ikhwani, in the case of the Sheikh, it may be that you hate something and it is a lot of good. One of the benefits of death is that when we see people dying around us, we have to take that as a sign that this is the sunnah of Allah that's going to happen to us. The closer people are to you, it makes you wake up. If someone dies who's far away from you, you may not take it personally. You hear there's a janazah, like today in Masjid al-Rahmah, an old lady died. May Allah have rahmah upon her, put in the Jannat al-Firdaus without any adab and any hisab. We go. I'm not connected to that lady. So it doesn't really touch me that close. But when people die, who we know, then it's a sign and indication. You're going to die as well. And number two, those people who are around you, your mother, your father, your close relatives, you don't have time to be wasting allowing ongoing disputes to keep you divided, especially when they're Muslims. Ongoing disputes that are there in front of us, and that person is not going to be there forever, and you're not going to be there forever. So in the case of the Sheikh, we hope that his death, inshallah, azawajal, is going to be an impetus or motivation for his family members to hold on to the rope of Allah and to hold on to their religion, and also to hold on to one another, to get close and to allow his death to be an issue that the people who are close to him are going to once again hold on to one another. And those of us, this is not our case, but the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said in an authentic hadith, As-sa'id man wu'idha bi ghayrihi. The one who's going to be successful, is going to be happy, is going to be in a good condition, is the one who learns from other people. Don't be one of those people who, when a mistake happens to you, we all should learn. This is a bad thing. I learned it. I got hit in the head. I got bit. I got stung. I got burnt by this particular thing, so I know not to go back to it. Everybody's going to learn in that way. He said, As-sa'id man wu'idha bi ghayrihi. That's kalam nabawi. The happy one, the successful one, is the one who learns from the mistakes of other people. You see someone else, something happened to them, then you don't fall into that same mistake. Don't do it. He threw his life away by doing something crazy. Don't you make that same mistake, because Allah put him there as a dars for you, as an ibr. He put that individual there as a lesson for you. Last thing that we want to mention about the Sheikh, and many things can be mentioned about him, is from the khair of the Sheikh and his dying, may Allah have rahmah upon him, is whenever the Muslim gets an opportunity to go to Mecca and Medina, the vast majority of his time, if not all of his time, is going to be spent doing the ibadat of al-Islam. It's not like here in the UK. When you go to Mecca and you go to Al-Medina, all your time is spent worshiping Allah. It's like a utopia. You can even say it's not really a real way of living, because you're only going to be there for 2 weeks. You take advantage of it, and then you come back to your real reality. But when you're there, you have to take advantage of it, because there are so many opportunities to engage in the favors of Allah in terms of those ibadat that are only there. So while we were there, from the Fajr time to the Isha time, it was nothing but studying, as I'm going to show you, inshallah. It was nothing but attending the durus of the Sheikh. And while you attend the durus of the Sheikh, you're in the haram of Mecca in Medina. You're going to pray in the Prophet's Masjid, all of the prayers. In the Prophet's Masjid, after almost every prayer, with the exception of two prayers in 2 weeks, there were only two prayers that there was no janazah. Every other prayer, every single day, there's not one janazah, but there's 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 janazahs. Every single prayer. So the Prophet mentioned, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, anyone who prays the janazah behind any Muslim, he'll get the reward of making the sadaqah. He'll get a qirat, which is the size of Mount Uhud, and giving sadaqah. If he follows the janazah, he'll get two. So there is a WhatsApp group. I would encourage you, brothers, to get on that WhatsApp group here. It started and initiated here in Green Lane Masjid, where some of the brothers are following the different masajid here in Birmingham. Wherever there's going to be a janazah, a day before, they make an announcement. There's going to be a janazah today after Salat al-Asr, Salat al-Dhuhr, in Masjid al-Rahmah. So if it's Monday, if it's Thursday, or if it's any day, the Muslim, he makes his way over to Masjid al-Rahmah. He knows them. He doesn't know the people who died, or he's not a frequent visitor to that masjid. His issue is tatabbu' al-khayrat. He's just running behind the good things in a land that doesn't help him to be religious. This place encourages me, it encourages you, encourages our wives, encourages our children to be disobedient slaves of Allah Azza wa Jalla. In the dars, the mu'tamar that I took, 2 weeks, I didn't hear any of this kalam about he's this, he's that. The sheikh said this about him, the sheikh said that about him. And that's because all of the time was filled with beneficial knowledge. And if people are getting beneficial knowledge, there's no time for that tila waqa. There's no time for it. Here in the UK, we have a lot of time on our hand. And as a result of that, we entertain all of this drama that's going on, being mentioned by the ignorant people. The Arabs, they say, فَاقَدُوا شَيْ لَا يُعْتِهِ. The one who doesn't have something, he can't give it. So if I were to ask you guys, hey, I need some money. Can you help me out? You don't work. You don't have any money. So you can't give it because you don't have it. As a teacher, if I have no knowledge, I have no benefit to bring to you, I don't know the Quran. I don't know the Sunnah. I have no knowledge about this religion. Then all I can do when I sit before you, all I can do is say, he's this, he's that, he's that. And I can run off to you some names of some sheikhs. But that's no knowledge. Teach me my religion. Teach me the basis of my religion. Put me in a position where I'll know how to worship Allah. I know who Allah is, who he is, and what he does, what he doesn't do. I don't have to make my dawah the dawah of sowing seeds, planting seeds of hatred between Muslims with all that we have on the table in terms of challenges. So from the benefit of the death of the Sheikh, rahimullahu ta'ala, is some of the students took the time out to go in to visit the Sheikh. He became a part of the everyday existence of the students, or some of the students who were there, just to go visit him in the hospital. And visiting the person who was sick, whether he's in a hospital or whether he's in someone's house or his house, is all the same. A number of malaika, they accompany you on the way. It's going to come for you yawmul qiyamah to go and visit someone in his house or in the masjid. There's a lot of rewards for that particular issue. And the Sheikh, he was responsible for that. So I just wanted to mention that, just to say that that was from the highlights of actually what happened on this particular trip. Because on the trip, I was asking, why did Allah allow me to come here? Out of all of these people who I know, Allah made it easy and he facilitated for me to come here. And I was asking myself, this Sheikh, he happened to go there before me and this happened to him. Why did Allah Azza wa Jalla make that happen to him? He died over there. Not asking that question in the way, why Allah, why the, no. But trying to figure out, what did I do to be put in this position where I could get these rewards? As for the Sheikh Ikhwani, Sheikh Salih ibn Abdullah ibn Hamd al-Usaymi, Ra'ahu Allah wa Hafidhu Allah, I met many of the ulama of al-Islam. And I met many of the tulabul ilm from the Arabs and other than Arabs who are aqwiya, very strong. They're not on the level of a Sheikh Nasir al-Din al-Albani, Ibn Baz, Ibn Uthaymeen, rahmatullahi alayhim ajma'in. They're not on the level of a Sheikh al-Fawzan, a Sheikh al-Luhaydan, al-Ghudayyan, the Mufti of Arabia. They're not on that level. They're not their age and they're not on that level. But the Sheikh, I never met anybody like him my whole life, out of all the people that I met. And that was because in what I saw in him is that I saw a balance in the Sheikh that I didn't see in many people prior to him. A seriousness in knowledge, because he didn't stay in Saudi Arabia just to obtain his knowledge. But he traveled to some of the very difficult places to get knowledge in the world, like Mauritania. Mauritania is one of the poor countries in al-Islam, but is a place where getting knowledge there is not like getting knowledge anywhere else. I don't encourage you to go there because it's a hot spot, and I don't encourage you to go there because life is difficult there. So I'm not encouraging anyone, go to Mauritania. It's a hot spot. It's next to Mali, Boko Haram, Al-Qaeda. All of that is going on in that place, all of that. So I wouldn't encourage you to go there. But they're on the way of studying from a long time ago where people memorize Alfiyatul Malik. He's going to memorize the Quran right away. He's not going to be in this majlis, the size and the ages that we are. You're this size, you're this age. If you're like this in Mauritania and you're a student of knowledge, you're going to already have the Quran memorized. And after memorizing the Quran, you're going to already have some of those easy, basic, simple books memorized. But you're going to get a really good grasp and deep teaching in terms of some of the more classical works in al-Islam. The Sheikh, he went to Mauritania. He went to Morocco. He even went to Pakistan. And you know, if you go get knowledge in Pakistan, Pakistan is tough. The Sheikh even knew English. I was shocked. He was speaking to me some words in English. I don't say that his English was flawless, but his English was well enough where I understood clearly what he was saying. I said, how did you learn English? He said, when I went to Pakistan, there were some people who knew English there, and I learned with them. I used to speak with them. And he asked me, did I know someone here in Birmingham? He asked me, did I know the Sheikh in London, Suhaib Hassan? How many of you know Suhaib Hassan, the Sheikh Suhaib Hassan? You know him. The man who used to be the imam there in Masjid al-Tawheed, and he used to be the ra'is of Jam'iyyah Ahlul Hadith. He used to be the ra'is of this particular Jam'iyyah a few years ago. He said that his father, whose name is Abdul Ghaffar Hassan, was one of the major ulama of al-Islam in al-Hadith in Pakistan. The Sheikh told me he traveled to Pakistan and he read the Sunan of Abu Dawood on his father from beginning to the end. And then he traveled and he met him in Mecca and he read all of Sahih Muslim from the beginning to the end. And what I mean by from the beginning to the end, because the Sheikh is a muhaddith on the way of the people of the past, not just reading the Hadith, but going through the narrations of the Hadith and knowing the men of that Hadith and knowing the nuances of both of those books. Now in English, I think I can safely assume no one here read all of Sahih or the Sunan of Imam Abu Dawud. I don't think anyone did that. I don't think anyone sitting here read all of the Hadith of Sahih Muslim. Just reading it without learning, without studying, without dealing with the fiqh, without dealing with the men in the chains of narration. So those type of people, they were serious in getting knowledge. You sit with the sheikh teaches you about each and every individual with a chain of narration. And that was another issue with the Sheikh Al-Usaymi that I went to sit with. Every time he would begin his class, he would begin his class with the same kalam. They would say to the people, the class I'm about to give you is the same class that I took from my sheikh. And then at the end of the class, they gave us a book that was free. You take and you make notes in the book. At the end, when we finish the book, he will give you the chain of narration of the people we took that particular class from. Now you become a part of that chain of narration that you took from him, who took from all of those other people. And I never had that opportunity before. Concerning the issue, Ikhwani, of studying there, on a daily basis, the Riyasatul Haram and Nabawi, the people are responsible for the Prophet's Masjid, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. They said on average, there were about 8,000 to 9,000 students in the class. That's more people than what attends the Khutbatul Jummah here on Green Lane, two times or three times. 9,000 students every day for 2 weeks. We're able to finish in that two-week period, 13, 14 books. When I say 13 and 14 books, they weren't small books. They were big books, and not a single word was left out of the book that was being explained. From them, the book that the Sheikh wrote himself, the book was called Ta'zim al-Ilm, making knowledge exalted and appreciating knowledge. It was the first book that we dealt with, in which he was encouraging the students to have ikhlas, to have etiquette, to be serious. Those ayat and those hadith that we heard a million times, but when I heard them this time, they were a bit different. Because I'm sitting and there are 9,000 other people, 9,000. And I'm not the type of person who can sit like this for a long time. I have to sit with my back against the wall because where I come from, we were not created to sit and we're not used to sitting on the earth. Plus, I'm over 50 years old. All of the universities in the kingdom, all of them, they were on their ijazah, doing their vacation, their holidays. So all of those kids from every university converged on Medina to be a part of this tremendous opportunity. So I'm 50, I'm over 50, and I'm sitting with little kids, the age of Zakariya and Ismail, Ibrahim, and Nur ad-Din. So I can't sit like this for a long time. I have to sit over there. And I have to compete with these kids. And it wasn't easy. It wasn't easy. It's been over 20-something years since I graduated. And I was a bit rusty. And these guys are learning right now. So they used to go to the masjid an hour before the adhan so that they could sit in front of the sheikh. My roommate in Medina was a brother who memorized the Quran from France, originally from Algeria. He knew two recitations, qira'atain from the Quran. He used to go every day, an hour before. I said, okay, I'm going to try to keep up with this kid. And I went, So I wound up sitting in the middle. But while I was sitting there, I was fidgeting, and everyone was looking at me. And I was looking at them saying, don't look at me. I'm doing my best. So, but I learned. It's not for me to sit in the middle because I'm going to disturb the people. So I would come at the time of the adhan, and I would sit on the wall where I can be comfortable. Because it's like that old story that we used to learn when we were young about the race between the turtle and the rabbit. I'm the turtle, and a young guy was the rabbit. And they were trying to run around the track. And I knew I had to take my time because we have 13, 12 days in front of us. Those guys going to burn themselves out. I have to take it easy. And I know that Allah doesn't want me to go beyond my ability. And that's the difference between older people and younger people. The person who was of age, he realizes, hey, you better slow down. You better take it easy and pump your brakes. The young guy, by the time the end of the daura came, they were missing many of the classes because they were tired. Your legs start hurting. You start oversleeping. And that's because they used to go at the beginning every day, an hour before the time. But miraculously, by Allah's permission, there were some who were able to be consistent throughout the whole thing, which I found was an amazing feat. So the point here is, I was in a situation that I've experienced different seminars when I was in Saudi Arabia in the past. When I studied every single summertime, I would go to Al-Qasim or Sheikh Saleh ibn Uthaymeen, Muhammad ibn Saleh ibn Uthaymeen, Rahimullah. He used to give his seminars. I used to go, but they weren't like this. Fajr time after Fajr, you do a book. We did Kitab al-Tawheed in a day and a half. A day and a half. And when I say Kitab al-Tawheed, I'm not talking about the Sheikh skipping chapters. He did every single chapter, every single line of the book. There were those people who wrote a lot of notes. There were those people who wrote some notes, like me. And there were some people who didn't write at all. They was just there for the barakah. Men who were older than me, who used to just come and they used to sit for the barakah. At about 9:30, we would all go back to our hotel rooms, which was, again, one of the ni'mas of that place over there. There's an Amira. She was a princess. She spent thousands of pounds from her own money in order to bring students from all over the kingdom so that they can participate in that program. Gave them transportation money, paid for the transportation, and paid for hotel rooms for all of those students. So I met a number of brothers who were from the UK, and they're studying in Riyadh, they're studying in Qasim. I met brothers who were from America, who were studying over there. They were able to come down because that particular princess, may Allah Azza wa Jalla put in her mawazin of hasanat, she gave him that sadaqah. So anyway, Ikhwani, I just wanted to share this really small experience with me. That was an awesome experience because, again, after going there and asking myself, why? Why did Allah choose me? I was trying to figure it out. Out of all of those students that were in that place, over 8,000, 9,000 students, the Sheikh chose 18 students. Out of 8,000, 9,000 students, he chose 18 to come one day just to have dinner with him. And it was no time for no dinner. It was just always really busy. I happened to be one of those 18 people. And that's when I really got an appreciation for how the Sheikh was. How he was offline, gentle, had a nice sense of humor, easygoing. And although he was like that, he was serious about the sunnah, about everything. There was an individual who was there, I believe he was sent by the newspaper, who were taking pictures of the Sheikh, and the Sheikh told him, don't take no pictures. He took responsibility for his majlis. But when things were going on and people were talking, he was real gentle. Him and I had the opportunity to go up in the elevator together with about four other brothers, and that's when he started talking to me in English, and I was shocked that he knew English. Easy going, gentle. He saw my tattoos. The Sheikh didn't go off and say, what are you doing with that? He just wanted to know, what's the story behind that? It was easy. He knows, because he mixed outside of the country, So he saw a lot of things. And that's one of the benefits of people like him. And I say to you, the ulama of Saudi Arabia, from the best ulama that this ummah has, the ulama from wherever you go. But when a scholar gets a chance to go out of his environment, the more that he sees, the more experiences that he has, the more he's going to be in a position to appreciate the differences that are going on in other people's lives. And the Sheikh, he had that. Traveling to Pakistan, traveling to Morocco, traveling to Mauritania, traveling all of those places that he traveled of difficulty in search of knowledge. Not going to eat ice cream and just chill out, but going in pursuit of knowledge and sitting at the feet of the people of those countries who had knowledge and taking from them the specialized knowledge that they had. Anyway, when we went up to his room, he had six trays of rice and lambs, six trays. But there was the special tray where the lamb had the head on it. And that was the tray I sat at with him. And as we were sitting next to each other, he was breaking the meat off to me, giving me the meat, talking to me in Arabic, talking to me in English, polishing up his English skills. And because I'm not really into eating the head of lambs, that's not from the culture of my people. We don't eat chicken feet. We don't eat fish heads. We don't eat lamb heads. That's not from the culture of my people. It's something that we say, oh, what is that? But he asked me, eat from the lamb's head. So I started eating from the lamb's head to try it out. And it tasted okay to me, actually. So as I started eating the lamb's head, I picked up the lamb's head. I was saying, Sheikh, this is really nice. He didn't get upset from me. He didn't get upset with me. He wasn't mad. He was just real gentle and easy. I was overwhelmed. I was really, really, really amazed at his rahmah. Amazed at how he was as a mu'allim. And again, it reminded me of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Rasulullah was not a rough and a tough person just like that for no reason. He was rough and he was tough when a tawheed was compromised. He was rough and he was tough when individuals, they compromised the hurumat of Allah ta'ala. They fell into ma'asi, to disobeying Allah and things like that. Then the Prophet would be rough at the time he should be rough. And some people who fell into ma'asi, he wasn't rough with them. Like the Bedouin man who urinated in the masjid, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and was gentle with that individual, radiallahu anhu. And that's how we find our ulama. As for any sheikh, any student of knowledge, any individual who his way is rough and tough and nasty, then he's not on the way of the Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Antisociable, difficult, he's making tanfir, running the people away. Everything is just hatred. Everything is warning. There's something that is fundamentally flawed with some of the concepts that some people have concerning this dawah that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam brought to us. So in a nutshell, ikhwani, I brought for myself a diary, and I used to write these things down of what happened every day. I said, okay, I have to remember these things to share with the people, but it was just too many things that had happened. We had an opportunity as well, alhamdulillah, to meet up with many of the students who had came from Birmingham, who were studying over there, who we advised them, stay out of the way of the nonsense that is going on over there with the brothers who didn't come to the dars of the Sheikh. Because unfortunately, with the Sheikh being on the level that he's on, and all of the ulama of Arabia unanimously praising him and telling people this is a person you get knowledge from, the ghulat of the da'wah of ghulu, the SP ghulu, they talked about the Sheikh as well. They didn't leave anybody. Sheikh Abu Zakaria. They didn't leave anybody. So they didn't come to benefit from the Sheikh. And they warned against the Sheikh. And when you ask, where's the dalil? Hatu burhanakum. Where's the dalil? There's no dalil. You know what the dalil is? He's not wadih. What do you mean he's not wadih? His durus are clear. His attire, the way he dresses, the way he looks, the way he behaves, it's the sunnah. But with those guys at SP, the usul with those guys is a shuck. They have doubt about people. Whereas the usul with the Muslim is husn al-dhan. You have to have a good opinion about people. until they prove you wrong. But because that dawah is a dawah of exclusivity, it's a dawah that belongs to them. It's their dawah. No, al-Islam is a dawah of inclusiveness. Inclusiveness. Everybody is to be included. Everybody. Until they eliminate themselves for one reason or another as a result of al-yaqeen, they get excluded from either the sunnah or the religion. Now, I don't want anybody to come to me and talk about the qawaid of Abu Hassan al-Ma'rabi and the qawaid of Ali Hassan al-Halabi. Everyone is included. Everyone is included. Everyone is from Ahl al-Sunnah. Don't give us that. My kalam is very clear. And that is, when I meet a Muslim from Indonesia for the first time, I have to have husna dhan about that brother. I look at how he dress, I look at how he behaves, and I say, that brother's on the Sunnah. This brother's on the Sunnah. Until I see and I hear from him what contradicts that thing. I don't meet a Muslim, I say automatically, I never seen him before, so I don't think he's a Muslim. I don't think he's on the Sunnah. I don't think, this is not our religion. It's not our religion. As for me saying, everybody is included in Ahl Sunnah, the Ikhwan, the Tablighi, the Sufi, everybody, the Sha'ira, I didn't say that. So don't come and fill the room up with that rhetoric, that hot air. Abu Hassan al-Ma'rabi. I asked my wife the other day, after we encouraged people, hey, we want to make Islah. We have a sheikh who's here, a Sheikh Salih Suhaimi. And I had the opportunity, alhamdulillah, while I was there recently, where we went to the sheikh's house, a Sheikh Salih Suhaimi, to have dinner with him. Some of the students were there from Yemen as well, who were from the students of the Sheikh Muhammad al-Wasabi, who had died a year ago or so. Rahmatullahi alayhi. His two sons were there, and some of his students from Yemen, and we were there as well. Had an opportunity to sit with the sheikh at his house, and he was also easygoing, generous, nice. While we were at the sheikh's house, or when the sheikh was here, we invited people, come on, let's make sulh. Let's make sulh. Let's make rectification. Here's a sheikh we could sit to, we could judge our case. You accept him, so let's sit. And then we were surprised, or we weren't really surprised, to hear from the people after that saying, no, we have to go to the house of Sheikh Rabir in March to sit with him. We're only going to sit with him. He's a sheikh with us. We have to take off from work and buy a ticket to go all the way over there to sit with Sheikh Rabir. What are you talking about? What is that? And in addition to that, we also heard this issue, Sheikh Salih Suhaimi. Hey, let's come and let's sit with him. We started hearing things about the people after that, instead of accepting the invitation, the principles of Abu Hassan al-Ma'rabi, the principles of Ali al-Halabi. Ask my wife, do you know who Abu Hassan al-Ma'rabi is? Abu Hassan al-Ma'rabi, you know who he is? She said, yeah, he's from the Tabi'een. Abu Hassan al-Basri, right? Abu Hassan al-Basri. I said, no, his name is Al-Hassan al-Basri. So what's the point here? She doesn't know no Abu Hassan al-Ma'rabi, just like you don't know Abu Hassan al-Ma'rabi. None of us know Abu Hassan al-Ma'rabi. So why are we making this an issue? And we have serious issues and things that are confronting us today. So with that being the case, Ikhwani, I say to you brothers, we have to get really serious about being students of knowledge. Students of knowledge, and here in this place in the UK, it's really a joke. I don't want to put anybody down, but I even include myself in that. We're not really, really, really being so serious the way seriousness can be when it comes to getting knowledge. So you brothers who are the consistent students here, Nuruddin, Sharif, Zakaria, all of you brothers, I'm encouraging you guys to become more serious. And one of the first steps that you can take in becoming seriously serious is enrolling in a Quran class and getting the memorization of the Quran and the recitation of the Quran. In this masjid right here, we have about three really good people, other than our imam. That brother Abu Usama from Libya, that brother Abu Tajweed, they call him, Abu Tajweed from Masjid al-Rahma, who comes over here. The most serious classes that take place in this masjid are the classes of the Quran. because it's the type of knowledge that is going to always stay with you, and you can always measure how well you're doing from day to day, week to week, month to month, year to year. So I would like to encourage all of you to get more serious about what's going on. As for these durus, we said alhamdulillah, they are from the dhikr. And the dhikr, it reminds the people, and inshallah ta'ala, causes us to remember if we forget. But real knowledge is sitting down, taking notes, and really going through books the way the people of the past used to go through these books. And the way we're doing it here, and we're not really blaming anyone. As a teacher, we have to understand the reality on the ground. It wouldn't make any sense trying to teach Alfiyat ibn Malik to this class when most of us don't even know Arabic. So why are we going to teach a difficult book like that? Why is that? Last thing is, inshallah azza wa jal, Sheikh asked everybody who was in that room, from the 18 to 20 people in that room, is this your first time coming to the seminar? Some people say yes, some people say no. It was my first time. I asked them, why are you asking? Inshallah azza wa jal, is going to be an annual thing. So next year, from this area, hopefully we'll be able to choose two or three other brothers who will be able to go with us, and we'll go over there. But you brothers who don't know Arabic, you're just out of the box. You just can't go because the thing is in Arabic. So that's the fadl of Allah. This is how it is. As for the Arabic-speaking brothers, inshallah, azza wa jal, hopefully we'll be getting the opportunity to get three, four different brothers who will go on the hisab of that princess or whoever's going to be responsible for it to take this awesome trip. So with that, inshallah, azza wa jal, we ask Allah to accept it from us, accept it from you. We're going to resume our classes. On Wednesday, we'll do Shama'il al-Muhammadiyah. Next week, we're going to complete the Qawaid of Asul. We're going to finish that last class. And we'll only have one class in Green Lane Masjid, which will be on the Wednesday, which will be Al-Shama'il Al-Muhammadiyya to Al-Imam Al-Tirmidhi bi-idhnillahi azza wa jal. If you brothers have any questions, you can put your question forward. Alindakum shay tafaddal ya akhi. No, it was in, this one was in Medina, although he did one in Mecca. As a matter of fact, doing Hajj, I had saw Aloha, an advertisement of him, but I didn't know who he was. I just read it, and I remember later on, I saw this before, and I heard he does this everywhere. He does it in Medina, he does it in Mecca, he does it in Riyadh, he does it in Qasim, he does it all over. And it was in the Prophet's Masjid, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or it's in Mecca, so it's for everybody to come. Anybody who wants to sit, he can sit. Anybody. But it was basically at this time, doing the midterm vacation for the students. So as I said, all of them, many of them converged on the place because of the barakah of Al-Medina and also because of the ilm of the sheikh and the shuhra of the sheikh. He was an extremely popular person that people want to get knowledge from him, especially in light of the fact that he has a chain of narration that goes all the way back to Al-Imam Sufyan ibn Uyayna, rahmatullahi alayhi. Fadli ahi. No doubt, as I told you, everything has its priorities and everything has its awliyat, things that are more important than others. And in getting knowledge, if a person doesn't know this particular issue, he can wind up putting himself in a position where he is wasting his time. So we're here in the UK. And being here in the UK, it is not going to work what the sheikh was doing there in the Prophet's Masjid, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. It's not going to work. I went to Indonesia and Malaysia and to Singapore, and I remember those students over there used to sit down, and they would sit very close together, and the class would take 45 minutes to an hour, and then the next class, 45 minutes to an hour, the next class, 45 minutes to an hour, and they would not get up, and they didn't need any break. I used to find that amazing and shocking. But that's what they were used to. that can sit like that and they can handle that type of pressure. When the shiuch come here and they give a talk and he's done, we have to give the people a 10-minute break, 15-minute break. And sometimes that turns into 20, 30 minutes because people have to get back. And when they're coming back, they're talking, they're making a lot of noise because this is we're in an environment where we're distracted. So we have to take into consideration our reality. That would never work here, and Allah knows best. But while we're here, we recognize our capabilities, and we also recognize those things that prevent us from being on that level over there. So getting serious here is, in my opinion and my advice, is setting your sights on a knowledge that is a serious knowledge, like the Quran. We are muqassirun as it comes to the Quran, muhmilun. How many people can say right now, I'm really doing well with my connection with the Quran? I'm memorizing, and someone is listening to me at the end of the week. What did I memorize? I'm learning the ahkam of a tajweed, and someone is teaching me, and they're at the end of the week asking me what's going on. So although you don't have to learn 7 qira'at, 10 qira'at, no. Just learn how to read the Quran properly and learn the ahkam of a tajweed, yarmalun. Just learn those of the noon and sakin, yarmalun. Start off with those issues. And that's a level of seriousness that most people don't have. I don't want anybody to raise their hand or anything like that. People listening to me right now, YouTube, listening to me right now, and you brothers who are sitting here, all you brothers who are sitting here, the vast majority of us are not learning the Quran. And I'm going to call myself Salafi, and yet the Salaf, they said that they used to learn 10 ayat of the Quran, and then they would move on. The Prophet would teach them the Quran, and he would focus on the Quran before everything else. Tafsir of the Quran, reading the Quran, understand the Quran, being connected to the Quran. Now we're connecting the people to the names of the books. I can see and I can tell you. At the Sheikh, we learned this book, Ta'zim al-Ilm, was the first book. After that, we took Fadlu al-Islam. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahab wrote a book called The Virtues of al-Islam. We took after that the book Usul al-Thalatha, Al-Usul al-Thalatha wa Adillatuha. After that, we took the book Kitab al-Tawheed. After that, we took Al-Aqidat al-Wasatiyya, the whole book. The whole book. After that, we took Al-Qawaid al-Arba. After that, we took Al-Waraqat. After that, we took Usul al-Tafsir, Ibn Taymiyyah. After that, we took Al-Imam al-Sa'di's book in a tafsir where he went over some of the tafsir of the smaller ayat in the back of the Quran. I mean, 13 books. It was a lot of information. A lot of information. So a lot of people can run off the names of these books, but he didn't do anything about the Quran. Asul al-Sunnah, Sharh al-Sunnah. He'll tell you, Ibn Taymiyyah said this, Ibn Taymiyyah said that, that book and this book. But again, he doesn't know anything about the noon and sakin. And he's talking about al-Jarh wa ta'dil. Get out of here with that stuff, man. Get out of here. So my advice is, get serious with the Quran, ikhwani, first and foremost. Fadli ya Sheikh, barakallahu fikum. The what? Both of them together are important. The meaning of the Quran and the hifz of the Quran, both of them are important. The one who memorized the Quran is important. And the one who understands the meaning is important. And the one who read it, all of it is important. The Prophet mentioned, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yuqalu li sahib al-Qur'an yawm al-qiyama iqra wartaqi warattil kama kunta turattil fi dunya fa inna manzilatak inda akhir ayat taqra'uha. Read the Qur'an the way you used to read it in the dunya and continue to rise as a result of reading it. Because your last place in the Jannah will be determined by the last ayat that you memorized. And that ayat is talking, the hadith is talking about the Hufadh of the Quran.
They are the Ahlullah wa khasatuhu. They are the people, the party of Allah, the special people connected to Allah. So that shows the importance of memorizing the Quran. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, al-hasana bi ashra amthaliha. The good deed will be tenfold. So anyone who reads alif, lam, mim, each one of those are ten hasana. Alif is 10, lam is 10, and mim is 10. So that's just reading the Quran. He just read it, memorize. He didn't understand. Just read it, he's going to get that reward. الَّذِي يَقْرَى الْقُرْآنَ وَهُوَ مَاهِرٌ بِهِ مَا سَفْرَةَ الْكِرَامَ بَرَرَ وَالَّذِي يَقْرَأُهُ وَيَتَتَعْتَوُ فِيهِ فَهُوَ عَلَيْهِ شَاقْ فَلَهُ أَجْرَانَ. Anyone who reads the Quran, it didn't mention about understanding. Anyone who reads the Quran and he's an expert in reading it, he'll be raised up Yawm al-Qiyamah with the angels. Anyone who reads it with difficulty, like us, Ajanib, us, Ajam, we're not Arabs, he reads it with difficulty, he'll get a double reward for reading. As for the understanding of the Quran, Allah Ta'ala mentioned in so many ayats when he talked about the Quran, لِيَتَدَبَّرُوا أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ, so that those people who understand would reflect. He revealed the Quran so that the people would understand that Quran. So all of them are important. All of them are important. And all of them have virtues, and we have to do our best in the three categories. All three of them. Reading it, memorizing it, and understanding it, and also applying it. Any more questions, Ikhwani? Okay, then inshallah ta'ala naktafi bihadha al-qadr. Hadha wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barak ala nabiyyina wa ala alihi wa ashabi ajma'in. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Hey, Dawood.